to this last crew talk of the year. Our speaker today is Hans van den Berg. And the history of the crew talk is dates about 1 year ago when I was preparing my wedding with Lars. And in the middle of all this complex preparation, Lars said, "Hey, by the way, I just read that my uncle got a famous prize. He was awarded the Arne Janssen Lifetime Achievement Award for exceptional contribution in teleconnection research. So in particular, he works on reliability and performance optimization of communication networks." And then I read a bit further. He's a professor at Twente University, investigates self-organization in ad hoc and mobile networks, in, for example, also in traffic and internet of services and smart grids. So I read this and I thought, this is the perfect match. I need to invite him for a crew. Oh. So I waited till our wedding day, and then I approached him, and I saw he cannot say no if I ask him on the wedding day. Perfectly, and now here he is.
So good strategy.
Well, no.
Peace the fourth, then you can read.
Okay, thank you for inviting me, Claudia. I would like to start with a disclaimer. I'm not a complexity scientist, let it be clear.
That's what you think now.
We redefine.
But let's say it's mostly dealing with complex systems, starting from communication networks. And nowadays we see more and more that communication networks more or less get integrated with other systems, physical systems, so we get the cyber-physical system, that kind of things. And what is a cyber-physical system? It's almost everything, I would say, where systems which are really tightly integrated with the internet. That's more or less my definition of cyber-physical systems. But I would not like to go into the discussion about definitions today, because, as I said already, I'm not a pure complexity scientist. I'm a telecommunication man. And a mathematician, at least I used to be a mathematician. A long time ago I started in that way, and that is also on the following slide. I did my MSc study here at the University of Utrecht in applied mathematics. Then I did a PhD at CWI, and eventually I graduated here at Utrecht again on stochastic operations research. Then I moved to KPN, where I did a lot of work on performance and design of communication networks. Started with the, let's say, good old telephone network, and then moved towards the direction we are nowadays, and I will tell more about it later on. Then I went to TNO. Actually, the whole KPN research unit moved to TNO around 2002, because in that time KPN was in trouble, financial troubles, and research was not the most important thing at that moment. So we were moved to TNO, but we are still doing a lot of work for KPN and also for other network operators, network vendors, and so on. I also moved to University of Twente for 1 day a week, and since 2016 I'm also working at CWI, so back at CWI since 2016 in the group Stochastics. As I already said, my main job is to work on design and analysis of communication networks, mobile networks, fixed networks, with the last 10-20 years focusing mainly on mobile and wireless networks. Planning, performance optimization, reliability, that are the kind of things I'm working on. And as I already said, more and more are these networks operating in context. So it's not anymore the case that you build a very general network and then use it for this application or for that application. No, networks are really tailored towards certain application domains. And that also made that I got more and more involved in, okay, what is going on in these domains, and what are the requirements in these domains, what are the developments in these domains. And that moved me also into, I think, the complexity of the self-organization issues playing in several domains. Okay, that's something about the background, but again, This also serves to show you, we have as a disclaimer, I'm not a complexity expert. By the way, do not hesitate to ask any question during the presentation. So what we see nowadays is what I often call a hyper-connected world, where all this type of systems operating in these domains are completely interconnected with the internet, with everyone, everything, at each moment, at all places. Okay, what am I going to do today? I'm first going into some more detail in about mobile ad hoc networks. I think mobile ad hoc networks are a very good example of self-organizing networks. And then I will go to self-organization in other domains and raise some, let's say, questions, remarks, whatever. And then maybe that can also fuel the discussions on these topics, because that was one of the goals I had. Sorry, I take another. So mobile ad hoc networks, often called MANETs. What is the idea behind it? Let's say usually networks have a certain infrastructure and a kind of central control. And that's completely lacking in these ad hoc networks. So there is, do you have a pointer maybe, Claudia? Or a stick is also good.
Do you know where the stick is?
You should
put
that. No, we should just put the handle. Someone took it probably.
Okay, you still too by the way, who knows about mobile ad hoc networks? Who have heard earlier about this? Yes, 1, 2, 3 persons, so not that many. So again, as I already said, usually networks, communication networks, have a centralized control, an infrastructure which takes care of the control of the network. That's not the case in mobile ad hoc networks. In these networks, actually, the network nodes, so the user devices, in fact, act as nodes in the network, so helps to forward messages from one point to another point. And it is a self-organizing system, so the whole thing has to be done in a distributed way. That's the main idea. And the main reason for having this type of networks is robustness. And originally, these type of networks were, let's say, invented in the context of military applications, like the internet, I think. They are, of course, also very useful in other contexts. For instance, in the case of natural disasters, when the infrastructure is broken, then you can still communicate by using these type of ad hoc networks. And they are also currently intended to be used for vehicular networks, so car-to-car communications, and sensor networks. They are very often used in all type of sensor networks, but I will come back to these examples later on.
What's DARPA? What is DARPA?
DARPA, that's Defense Agency Research and so on. It is, let's say, the organization that funded the research that led to the internet in the 60s. research on mobile ad hoc networks started around 1995 in the US, as I already said. After 2010, we mainly see that the research on MANETs is in the context of special application domains with special requirements. The main research topics on this on these ad hoc networks are, for example, routing, distributed routing, which is a quite usual and considered topic in also other contexts. Resource allocation, media access control, performance analysis and optimization. I will say more about that in the next slides. Quality of service differentiation, and so on. That are, let's say, the type of research topics that has been considered in the last 20, 30 years. And actually, now maybe apart from routing, I think routing has really studied very, very heavily. All the other things are still not solved, and I think there is no one solution, of course, at the end. But it's too complex to get really a good finger behind, for instance, the performance. How or what are the important parameters, and in which sense do these parameters influence the performance in a quantitative way? Okay. Now, one of the most, I think, well-known examples of mobile ad hoc networks, wireless ad hoc networks, is the wireless LAN, or the Wi-Fi, as we have it, most of us will have it at home. It's a very simple example of a wireless ad hoc network where you have only one hop. And the one hop is maybe between individual users of the wireless LAN at home, for instance, or from between, let's say, one of the users and the access point, so that there are two possibilities. So only one hop that makes the analysis of this type of networks quite relatively easy. How does it work? Maybe first say something more about that. What is the main idea about it? But in principle, it's not possible, or let's say essentially, it's not possible that two users transmit their messages at the same time, because they use the same frequency, the same radio spectrum, and if they use it at the same time, then the message will collide and no one will understand the message. Now, what is possible distributed solution for this? That is to have a kind of random access with some distributed coordination. So the main idea is when a node, when a user wants to send a message, then he listens to the medium until it is free. Then he waits a random time between zero and what is called the contention window, and then he starts to transmit a data packet. And if the packet has a collision, if there is a collision, so someone else started to transmit exactly at the same time, then the same procedure is repeated with a double contention window. So if two times, there is two times a collision, four times a contention window, and so on. So you already feel that once collisions start to happen, that the system becomes quite slow. Let's say it like that.
So is there any research on whether this is the optimal framework?
Sorry?
Whether this is the optimal way forward? Because you have this doubling, but it can just be...
There has been a lot of research on what are the right ways to, increase the contention window, and also there are many parameters which are not shown here, and they have been investigated quite heavily what is most,
efficient. Is there any, this is as efficient as we know now, or is mathematical results that say this is the maximum efficient you can achieve?
No, for the single hop, there are a lot of mathematical results.
Yes,
okay. I'm not sure whether there are results for the most efficient way or the most optimal way, but for the multi-hop, it's much, much more complex. And there are only few results available.
And so probably it's also, you have three is
both free in receiving and in sending. The hub can also send, I presume.
Yeah. Okay, there has been obtained fundamental results again about this single hop system, Wi-Fi system, by Bianchi around 2000, and he modeled the whole thing as a kind of as a Markov chain, in fact. And it appeared that this Markov chain had very, very nice properties, so that he could come to explicit expressions for the throughput, for instance, that can be achieved. And here we have some results taken from that paper, which shows the throughput, the aggregate system throughput, as a function of the number of, yeah, let's say, active users that are actively trying to transmit data. And what you see is that yeah, in the very beginning, the system throughput increases still a little bit, which is quite obvious, because with two or three people you can better fill the capacity, the available capacity, than with only one. But as soon as the number of users becomes somewhat higher, the system more or less collapses. And that is due, what I said before, mainly due to the, let's say, collisions that happen. And then retransmission has to be done, and so on. And a retransmission actually does not, or a collision, takes capacity, but does not add to the throughput, of course.
What's the difference between the orange lines and the blue line?
Then I have to look at this.
Too difficult.
Yeah, that has to do with different, let's say, propagation conditions. Yep. Okay, then one step further. In the previous example, it was the case that users are constantly trying to send data. So they have an enormous amount of data available and want to transmit it over the wireless LAN. That's of course not the most, let's say, realistic situation. In reality, what you will see is that people try to transfer documents, flows, whatever, transfer parts of data over the wireless LAN. And the question is, okay, how long will that take? That's another question you can ask yourself. So that was also investigated some 15 years ago. And what was done at that time was to model this system more or less as a queuing system, where the server represents the, let's say, the radio channel, which is shared by all users. And arrivals are, let's say, the flow transfers, which users would like to initiate, which may happen according to a certain random process. And then the question is, how long for an individual user, how long does it take to transfer a certain flow of a certain length over this medium? And using part of the results of Bianchi, it was found that this can also be, again, quite simply modeled, or can be modeled by a quite simple model, and achieves really very good results. To show that at this slide. So what we got was here as function of the data traffic load. So let's say the number of users that are now and then trying to send and flow over the wireless medium. And here the transfer time. So the time needed on average to transfer such a flow. And this gives simulation results and analytical results, which are almost the same. And the nice thing which was found that there is a kind of insensitivity property. So the results are completely independent of the flow size distribution, so the flow content distribution. They depend, of course, on, let's say, the average flow size, but not on the higher moments. And that's a very attractive property, of course. Then we go to the multi-hop case. Let's do it like this. What is the situation? It's a very simple network, of course, a linear network. What appears is that the throughput through such a linear network when someone wants to communicate here to here, for instance, that it is really low, because transfers of data can happen simultaneously only at two points. So at only at 2 points you can transfer at the same time data. And that's, of course, for instance, in fixed networks, you can transfer data in parallel from this or from these two between these two nodes and so on. But in radio networks you cannot do that, because you have interference. So one transmission causes interference to other nodes, so they cannot transfer at the same time. This is a very simple example, but it already shows one, that efficiency in multi-hop situations is not that big. And secondly, there are a lot of intricate dependencies which make it really very difficult to analyze this type of networks. Then you can say, in this example, we have an interference range, so that means if one is sending or transmitting, then he will disturb other nodes, two nodes far away, let's say. You can say, okay, let's decrease the power so that the interference range becomes smaller. So then you can reuse the capacity more often, so use it in parallel more often. But then you have another problem, and that is the connectivity. Then the connectivity may decrease, so there is no power enough to reach your closest neighbor, and then you have another problem, of course. So in practice it will always be, let's say, a challenge to find a good balance between the power, so the range, transmission range, on one hand, and the throughput and connectivity on the other hand.
Do they necessarily need to all have the same power, or would it be smart to have some with high power and high connectivity?
Yeah, there are a lot of possible situations, all kinds of, let's say,
variations.
These variations have been or are investigated. Also, dynamic power control, for instance, is also a possible solution, but it it requires more and more intelligence, of course, in the nodes to achieve these things. Because the nodes can move, so the situation may change from time to time. Yeah, what is interesting, some fundamental results which I took from literature. One of them is about the connectivity I already talked about. What you will see is that if you spread the nodes in a random way over a certain surface, then you will see that if you start with very small power, then of course the connectivity will be completely zero, because you can reach no one. If you increase the power, then it is seen that quite suddenly, or even very suddenly, there is a step from almost zero to almost one connectivity. That's a very interesting result, which is also known from percolation theory, where you have similar phenomena. But this gives, of course, very useful insights. For instance, if you have a sensor network, what kind of power do you need to give the sensors such that there is almost always connectivity between each pair of nodes? And that's very important to find, let's say, the minimum power that achieves that, because in sensor networks it's often the case that they are very, let's say, energy consumption sensitive, in the sense that they have only very small batteries. Capacity of static ad hoc networks, so not mobile ad hoc networks, but static ad hoc networks, was investigated quite heavily, and people came up with fundamental results around 2000. And the same holds for mobile ad hoc networks, so the nodes are moving around. And what appears is that if the nodes are moving around, the capacity becomes larger than for a static situation. If the delays, the delay requirements are not that tight. If the delay requirements are tight, then you have a problem. But if they are not that tight, then you will see that the mobility increases the capacity of the network.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
What means not so tight? I mean, if I know that when I talk on the phone, there's a delay in the phone, and sometimes, certainly with Skype, you actually notice that, or, but in most cases we don't. What kind of delays are you talking about?
No, I'm talking here about, let's say, delays in the sense of 100 millisecond, 500 millisecond, so sub-second delays.
Something that we probably won't notice.
Yeah. Now, what I already said is very complex to analyze these type of systems due to the dependencies going on. One possible, let's say, one situation where that provides some more possibilities for analysis is the following situation, which may happen quite often, where the whole network is more or less at some point in time divided into parts and still connected with one single node, which then of course forms a kind of bottleneck node. And the question is, how severe is this bottleneck in this in such type of situations? Now, I will not go into the details of the analysis, but again, you can map this situation on a queuing type of model. So we have two hops in this case. One hop is from the source nodes to the bottleneck node, and the second hop is from the bottleneck node to the destination nodes. In this model, there is an important dependency which results from this situation, where if, let's say, the source nodes are active, then the bottleneck node is not able to transmit this the content of his buffer to the destination nodes because of these collisions which may happen. Now, you already feel that if this is the situation, that the bottleneck node is really a bottleneck, because when work comes in, you're not able to process other work. So accumulates, that's my word. Of course, one option is to say, I give the bottleneck node a higher priority, so a larger share of the network capacity of the spectrum. That's of course a possibility to deal with this situation, but that's at least not according to the standard, and again requires some additional intelligence in the network nodes in order to achieve that, because you have to know how many other nodes are trying to transmit in that type of things. Now, these results already show how essential this bottleneck is, in the sense of if you increase the load of the system a little bit, even around 0.1, 0.2, it starts to, the transfer times, the flow transfer times, already start to increase and become really very, very high, below a load of 0.5 of the system capacity. So it's really very, very bad situation.
I presume that you do this random arrival of content, or
sorry,
that you model this random arrival of content. So there must be fluctuations in the aggregate supply of content. Is there any thinking about smoothing that by putting delaying less important messages or something like that, pricing it?
I have not seen that. No. Yeah, I have seen studies where they give priority to messages that are more delay sensitive than messages that are less delay sensitive, voice packets, for instance. But not that systematically, as you may have in mind. This is for the case that you give a higher, let's say, share, a larger share of the bandwidth, of the capacity to the bottleneck node, and then you see that there is a shift to the right before the delays start to increase. Some examples of mobile ad hoc networks. As I already said at the beginning, sensor networks are very often using ad hoc networks. In many cases, they are not mobile, but fixed, of course. They have fixed positions, the nodes. In agriculture, for instance, precision agriculture, where they do measurements in the surface on water, humidity, all kinds of voedingsstoffen.
Nutritions.
There, as I already said, energy efficiency is really a very important issue because these nodes are all the sensors equipped with very small batteries and in the ground, so they cannot use solar energy. Otherwise, you try to use that, of course. So battery lifetime is very important, and also the strategies you are using for transmitting the data from one point to another point has to take that into account. And one of these strategies, for instance, is to introduce a kind of sleep mode. So the sensors sleep for some time until they have something to transmit, or until someone else has something to transmit, and then it wakens up. Does his duty and then start to sleep again. That's more or less the idea. The second very important one, application in vehicular network for autonomous driving. That's a variant of the basic wireless LAN protocol, is used or was intended to be used for car-to-car communications. But there is now, let's say, a fight going on between, on one hand, the IEEE and manufacturers making these type of networks, and on the other hand, I should say, the cellular networks, network world, like Ericsson and Nokia, that type of Huawei, the Chinese, big Chinese manufacturer, who are now preparing for a new technology, 5G, which will be introduced, at least the first releases will be introduced next year. And this 5G, the nice thing of 5G is that it does not, let's say, work according to the traditional cellular networks, not only work according to this ideas behind traditional cellular networks, but it also has a kind of, let's say, ad hoc mode. So when it is useful, it can work in an ad hoc mode, but when it is needed, it can work in a cellular mode. It's an infrastructure mode where transmissions are controlled by a central controller. So in this case, that's the base station cellular networks, which you can all see along the highways, for instance. And that, in particular, when it becomes busy in the air, let's say, then central control is much more efficient than distributed control. And again, these 5G networks can switch between the two modes, ad hoc mode and the central control mode. And that makes that now, as I already said, there's a debate going on, which is better to use, let's say, the candidate which was previously suggested, the ad hoc, pure ad hoc network, which was previously suggested to serve autonomous driving or 5G. And that's a fight between politicians, and industries, of course. Okay, I think this finishes my first part about ad hoc networks, and then I have a second part which is shorter, so don't worry.
I just have one question about your last comment, that the central network is more
The network is central control.
Yes, sorry, the network of central control is more efficient, you say, or effective?
More efficient if it becomes busy.
Okay.
If it is not busy, then distributed control is more efficient. Because there is a small probability, for instance, if you use this random access approach, there will be no collisions. And then it's more efficient to let the users decide themselves what they have to do than to let a central controller decide about it.
Okay, that seems counterintuitive to me, but I'm just trying to think how I should. Like, if you have a city that you try to feed, if you were to centrally control it, it is proven less effective. It's probably one of the reasons why the Soviet Union had a problem when they tried to centralize it. Then when you do it,
is that about the economy or?
So what I'm trying to see the I find it it's very interesting findings. I'm intrigued by it, but
now let's say maybe that's also one. I did not say it explicitly. I think in my next presentation, but I think when we talk about distributed control, central control, self-organization, complexity, or whatever, I think it depends a lot what is useful, what is best. Depends a lot on the features of the system and the requirements of the system. What I see, for instance, when I talk with people from logistics, for instance, they talk nowadays about self-organizing logistics. We want to have self-organizing logistics. They talk about the physical internet. I'll come back to that with some slides. My first question always is, okay, what do you want to achieve? What is your requirement? What do you want? Where do you want to improve compared to the current situation? And then they often do not really know. They say they have some ideas. Yeah, it should be better. We should earn more money at the end, something like that. But they do not have a clear vision on what should be improved. And why do you think that will be improved by introducing self-organization? I think that's often a problem, an issue. And depends a lot on the domain, the type of company or the type of system we are talking about, and again the requirements you want to achieve. So my next presentation